Hello again, everyone, for part two of higher level DNA structure. Today, we're going to look at how people figured out that DNA was the genetic material with the famous Hershey and Chase experiment. And then we'll also look a little bit at how DNA diffraction works when Rosalind Franklin discovered the structure of DNA. Now, this first one. Analysis of the results of the Hershey and Chase experiment providing evidence that DNA is the genetic material. Now, until the 1950s, no one was sure if DNA was the genetic material. They thought it might be protein. DNA only has four letters, A, T, C, and G, while proteins have 20 amino acids. And people looked at organisms like human beings and said they're far too complicated to be coded for using only four letters. So perhaps proteins are the genetic material. They were wrong, but that was a strain of thought. Now we know that DNA, your whole body, is coded for using the four bases of DNA. Now, Alfred Hershey and Marta Chase were working together to study viruses. They weren't married or anything. She was his lab assistant. And they're both quite well known today. And they knew that viruses, the thing they were studying, had two components, protein and DNA. So you can see in black the protein and on the inside the DNA. They also knew that viruses replicate, they make babies, by injecting their genetic material into cells. So, knowing that they're only made of protein and DNA, and that they inject their genetic material, they figured out that if they knew whether the viruses were injecting the protein or the DNA, they would know which one was the genetic material. The one, because viruses are made of proteins and DNA, and they inject their genetic material into cells, if they could figure out which one was getting injected, they'd know which one was the genetic material. So, they decided to grow the viruses in two different liquids or mediums. In one, they grew viruses with radioactive sulfur, sulfur 35, it's an isotope, which made the proteins radioactive or radio-labeled. And they also grew viruses in radioactive phosphorus that made the DNA, the phosphate groups, be radioactive. Don't worry too much about remembering sulfur versus phosphorus, but you should remember that they made radioactive protein virus and radioactive DNA virus. So, radioactive protein virus and radioactive DNA virus. Then, they had both types of virus infect some E. coli bacteria. Once the bacteria were infected, they killed them, centrifuged them to separate the materials. And when doing this, the viruses stayed in the top of the centrifuge while the bacteria moved to the bottom, whereas before they were mixed. Then they looked to see where the radiation was. If the bacteria were radioactive, that meant that the genetic material was in them. So let's have a look. They found that bacteria were only radioactive when the viruses with radioactive DNA were mixed with them. That meant that the DNA was the genetic material, because only the DNA went into the bacteria. When the bacteria with radioactive protein were mixed into them, that stayed in the viruses. It never went into the bacteria. So again, red is radioactive. So here we have radioactive protein viruses, here we have radioactive DNA viruses. Both of these viruses attached to cells and injected their genetic material, the DNA. Then they blended them and centrifuged them to separate, and they found that when the DNA was radioactive, the bacteria became radioactive. That meant that the viruses were injecting the DNA, so DNA was the genetic material. It's a really clever experiment, and it really helped prove that DNA was the genetic material. Now, let's talk a little bit about how Rosalind Franklin worked out that DNA was a double helix in antiparallel strands, with sugar and phosphate on the outside and bases on the inside. So, Rosalind Franklin worked a lot with a man named Maurice Wilkins in the same lab at King's College, and they used something called X-ray diffraction to study DNA. To do this, they basically took DNA and purified it, and then made crystal fibers that they stretched. Since it's a crystal, when they shot it with X-rays, it created a pattern, just like when you shine a flashlight at a crystal chandelier. So, when the X-ray hit the crystal of DNA, it made a pattern, and they could study this pattern to figure out the shape of the crystal. The most famous picture that Rosalind Franklin took was that was called Photo 51, and this was her 51st, number 51, photo of DNA. And here's the photo. And from this picture, you can see, not me personally, but an expert can see that DNA is a double helix and can see how many bases per turn and the width of the molecule. So from this picture, she knew that DNA was double-stranded, that the bases were inside and the sugar and phosphates were outside, and that DNA twisted to make a double helix. It's a lot of information. Now, Watson and Crick actually got this picture without Franklin's permission, and they used the data from this picture to make their model of DNA, for which they won a Nobel Prize. Franklin did not win the Nobel Prize, because she had died. So, Watson and Crick not only immediately figured out the structure of DNA with this information, they also immediately realized they now knew how DNA was copied. They had learned that A binds with T and C binds with G, thanks to Chargaff, and they knew the base bond length from Franklin's photos, so they knew that a purine must bind with a pyrimidine. So, if purine has to bind with pyrimidines and A and T and C and G are always the same amount, then they figured out that A must be binding with T and G must be binding with C. So they figured out complementary base pairing. And they also figured out that it only fits into Rosalind Franklin's model, which was antiparallel, if they were antiparallel. So that told them that DNA must be copied in opposite directions at the same time, with A's being attached to T's and C's being attached to G's. Now, we'll get more into that in our next lecture on DNA replication. Have a great day, guys. Ciao.